When I was building this flat car, I promised there'd be some upgrades to it to make it not quite so unpainted and make it run better. So today is the first of those. I'm going to give it a paint job. And being a rail car, it needs to be a typical rail car color. Since I'm modeling CNR in the 1970s, these would be the appropriate color, either a freight car red or a boxcar red. If you take a peek at the splotches on the lids, they're very, very similar. Either one will do. I'm not that much of a stickler because it's going to be weathered anyway. This car, I did some looking up, and CN did have a bunch of these 40-foot cars. A lot of them were built in the 30s and retired before my era, but there were also some that were built a little bit later and lasted well into the 70s, and even a couple that lasted into the 1980s in maintenance away service. So I've done a bit of research online and found some CN roster information from that era, and that is the car that I'm going to be decorating this for, one of the ones that ended up in maintenance service in the 80s but was still in existence and working hard in the 70s. And I've actually got a photo of one that I took in the 80s, which I'm going to be using for most of my reference. It did have the high-mounted brake wheel like this, although it had an extra piece that was extended up here to act as a hand grab for the crews stepping up on the stirrup and the grab iron there so they could get up easier. I'm not sure if I'm going to model it loaded or model it empty. The photo that I have has some looks like what random debris on it. I wish I'd taken more pictures, but back then I was shooting 35 millimeter and paying for developing, and I just didn't have the cash to burn through frames the way you can now on digital. So that's what's going on here. So in order to paint it, I have to take off all the parts that I don't want painted, which is basically reversing the last things that you saw me doing. Take the trucks off. Now then, the underframe, I am going to paint, but it's going to get a whole bunch of weathering on it. The couplers, I'm not going to use these anyway, so I'm going to take them off because they don't really... I'm going to get a smaller screwdriver for this. Actually, yeah, that could be easier with that off. Pop those couplers off. And then the car weight, I'm going to just paint with black craft paint. Not that's brown, but just cheap dollar store or Michael's or wherever you get your cheapest possible craft paint. The underframe I am going to paint, as I said, but I'm not going to worry about doing a super duper thorough job on it, and I am going to mask off the truck bolsters so I don't get paint on there. I'm going to mask off the coupler boxes so I don't get paint in there because I just need to scratch that off anyway. So basically, there's different ways of doing this. You can do like this. Remember, this part is going to be under the trucks and under the body of the car anyway. If it was a contest model, I would take a different approach, but this is going to be an old, heavily weathered car that's kicking around in the maintenance yard. So I just want it to operate well. I don't actually, I'm not going to get too stressed if it's not absolutely pristine. Remember, we're starting with a cheap car that's not an accurate prototype of anything in particular anyway. So it's not worth losing sleep over tiny details. And as I've mentioned before, on my railroad, the 3-foot rule applies. If you can't see a detail from 3 feet away, then it doesn't matter. There, that's that. I'm going to do the same all around there, but I'll do that later. And now for the couplers. A couple of pockets. Again, this isn't so much for looks as it is for making sure they work when we're done here. I could have used, especially on this part, I could have used the full width of the tape. But this is just easier to work with. You could just as easily do it this way. There. That's that ready. I think I'm going to mask off the bolsters under there too. That wasn't exactly what I wanted. And again, masking those off, not for cosmetic reasons, but to keep the paint from getting in there and crudding them up. Because I do want it to run well afterwards, just as well as a cheap car can be made to run. Okay. That's that. Next step. These things, when they were being injected and molded, will have had a bit of mold release, which is a lubricant put on them. That is the opposite of what you want for paint adhesion. So, I'll take a little bit of alcohol. In this case, it's methanol, I think. And cheap as possible from a discount store that doesn't exist anymore. $1 for 500. No, they're not Q-tip, but they're Q-tips. And just give them a scrub. Make sure there's no oil on there. It's also going to get rid of fingerprints and stuff like that, which will cause you problems with your paint sticking. And this isn't rubbing alcohol from the drugstore, because that also has oils and perfumes potentially and other stuff in it. This is 99.9 from the paint department of your hardware store, which is also cheaper. See a theme? Of course you do. I'm just going to do this all the way around. Get all that grease and stuff off of there, which will make the paint much happier. Get into all those little nooks and crannies. Well, that's a little less of a concern. Well, it's not really. This thing's got all that rivet detail on the sides. It'd be nice if you could see it through the paint. Of course, if there is a little bit flaking off and stuff, I'm modeling an ancient car here, right? It will have been in service for 20, 30 years by the era that I'm modeling. So there's that guy. A fresh one for down here. And yeah, if there's some paint flaking and peeling, or if there's some minor rough spots, I'm not stressed. And again, on the underside, it's going to have mud on it. I'm going to spray under there afterwards, after the car's reassembled again. I'm going to spray under there with some weathering type paint. colors of which are creatively called grimy black, mud, soil, dust, things like that. Okay, I'm going to let that dry for a little while, and I'm going to gather up my awesome custom-made paint booth. Here's the paint booth in all its glory. Let me run you through what we've got here. We have traditional Canadian craft dinner box, case of eight. We have a piece of furnace filter media, the professional heating cooling guys get that in bulk rolls of ridiculous length. This one is, I think, 1.5 inches thick. Up here, we have a light bulb, a cheap Chinese light bulb that used to be up above my workbench there. We have a little tinfoil shade slash reflector, which serves the dual purpose of not blinding me and reflecting more light down onto where I'm working. And around the back, we have an old computer fan, which is powered by a power brick from an original BlackBerry. Before they had a full-size screen, when it was more of a two-way pager. It may not have even been called BlackBerry then, but it's 12 volts, and that's enough to get that going. I am also going to put on a secondary filter after that, just in case the primary filter, that piece of furnace filter, doesn't do the trick. Okay, here we are set up. I was planning on using the same airbrush that you saw me use in a previous video in the when I was painting the clouds on my backdrop. Unfortunately, when I cleaned it after that project, I lost a part, which annoys me greatly. So I'm going to be using this cruddy old plastic one that I got from Princess Auto any number of years ago. It's entirely no name. It is a single action airbrush instead of a dual action airbrush like the other one is. And you adjust the paint flow with that. You do not adjust the airflow. Well, sort of, I guess, there. And that's it. While I was paused, I mounted the car frame, or the car body, up on these fancy holders. Clothespins, bamboo skewers from the dollar store, chopped down to an appropriate length. Okay, I'll just go and turn on the compressor and I'll be right back. When I said go and turn on the compressor, that's because I have it in another room. So let's see what happens here. Oh, I'm getting color. I know what else I need to do. Turn on the exhaust fan. Okay. And up the volume of paint just a little bit here. I don't want to go too high because I don't want it to run and streak and stuff. But I do want to get good coverage. As I'm turning it, it's going to go a little bit at a time, and that way I can get all the angles, and I don't have I'll paint shadows behind different features, hopefully. I'm still getting paint coming out here. Why does that keep? Come on. There we go. If there's any lesson from what I'm doing today, it's probably don't buy a crappy airbrush. Is that, this is, there we go. Normally I'm an advocate of cheap tools. Not in this case. Cheap airbrush just annoys you. If you can find a 40% off coupon or something like that from Michaels. They carry Badger and I think they carry Pache too. Do that. Do yourself a favor. Save up. If you're going to be doing any painting at all, get a decent airbrush. And here we go again. Okay, so that's that guy. A quick hit on the underframe. Oh, self-turning, isn't that cool? And again, I think what's happening here is the nozzle is just getting clogged up because this is polyscale or poly-S paint, which is an acrylic, but it is designed as a model paint. Model railroad colors. It has, there we go, water-based, non-toxic, full-quill poly-S color. No longer available. Because they were bought out by a bigger paint company, and after a while, the bigger paint company decided they didn't want that brand and closed it down. Not sure why the hell they bought it just to close it down, other than maybe they didn't want the competition for their other paint. I don't know. But now, fortunately, I've got some in stock. Because I never throw anything away. But I've had to thin it a little bit, and it's a little, well, enough shaking. You've seen my paint shaking video. If you haven't, I will link it down below, because I think my method of heavy duty paint shaking is completely awesome. Hey, I'm going to call that done. I'll just go shut off the paint sprayer and let this dry for a while. Oh, and of course, clean up my airbrush. Hopefully this time without losing any parts. Okay, some time has passed. Put the paint booth away, cleaned up the airbrush. That's one thing about that cheap airbrush. It is easy to clean. It has less moving parts in it. But I am a little disappointed in the finish. Let me just zoom in here. Let's see, it didn't get. Actually, that's dry. I can take that off. Didn't get super good coverage on the sides. Still a little spotty and splotchy. On the deck, it looks okay. Well, it's a little thin and splotchy in places too. The end frames, even though I spent some time on. Well, that one's not too bad. This end, if I can get into the light. Yeah, there's still a lot of black showing through there. From this angle, this guy looks okay. From the sides, the paint is painfully thin. So I think I'm going to leave it there. The lesson is, the moral of the story is, cheap airbrushes just aren't worth it. Maybe for weathering, maybe for scenery, not for getting a good paint job on something like this. So I'm going to do some parts ordering for the airbrush. See if an art supply store locally has one in, has some parts in stock, which would be the best. And get back to this. Disappointing, but that's the way life goes sometimes. Anyway, the actual painting was easy. Yeah, it's just the tool was crap. So there we go.